We're going to look at some RAP sounding errors and what the impact on short-term forecasts. Here is a Corpus Christi sounding at 12Z in the morning, end of May 2015. It's a pretty good looking sounding from a thermodynamic perspective. We've got a steep lapse rate in EML here from just above 850 to above 700. We've got a lot of cape, but we also have this inversion. And what's that inversion probably going to do, at least in the near term? We're going to get convection just spontaneously develop, not without a great deal of vertical motion or some forcing to help things. All right, so we know what the observed sounding looked like. Let's take a look at the RAP sounding. Uh-oh. What happened to that inversion in the model? Where is it? Come on, Kenzie. It's gone. The model says what inversion? It's got even more cape, 4,300, and virtually no CN. So what's going to happen in the model when it analyzes something like that? Let's take a look. First hour of the forecast, from 12 to 13Z, precip in southeast Texas. There's the radar on the right. Let's take a look at the forecast soundings. This is the 1 hour forecast. No inversion, lots of instability. 2 hour, 3 hour, 4 hour, 5 hour, 6 hour. First 6 hours, it doesn't recover. Sometimes you may see, all right, it'll build the inversion in once it gets into balance. We don't see that. So what does that mean for the precipitation? Well, we already saw this. 1 hour precipitation between 12 and 13Z, that's erroneous. What about the next hour? Between 13 and 14, shows precip. There's a little hint at trying in the radar along the sea breeze. Between 14 and 15, but in the real world, it doesn't really make it over the hump, but the model keeps forecasting precipitation. By 16Z, 17Z, 18Z. So if you said, I don't need to look at observational data, I can look at the model. It'll tell me what's there at the 0 hour time and move it forward properly. Moved it forward, and as long as you ignore all the precip that the model was putting out, you'd say it was a pretty good forecast. How about another case? We'll look at a cool season case. We'll look at the GFS. This is January 21st of 2016, not the 21st of January 2017 outbreak, but we had severe on this day too. Here's the 12Z Lake Charles sounding. It's got some elevated instability, several layers of steep lapse rates, almost 1,700 joules of instability from lifting a parcel just above the surface. What did the GFS initial sounding look like? Compare them. Looks like the difference is just a little bit, but actually the lapse rates are quite a bit different. And look at the moisture trace, how it dries out in the model. So instead of having almost 1,700 joules, it's got 518 joules, or an error of about 1,100 joules right at the start time. And it's too dry, 10 grams instead of 11.5. This is a Shreveport. This has almost 1,500 joules of elevated cape. You can clearly see the cool stable layer. What about the model initial sounding? Quite a bit less. Almost 900 joules, too low in this case. So the GFS is starting out with not enough instability, not enough moisture. So if we look at the RAP analysis of most unstable cape on the left, and the green area is greater than 1,000, there's some similarity, but it does appear as if the GFS is too confined, too restricted. What about 6 hours from now? We had special soundings that day. That's the 18Z sounding from Lake Charles. Over 2,500 joules of mu cape. How about the forecast from the GFS? Well, we'll go back and forth, and you see it's not warm enough, it's not moist enough near the ground. It cools it off, and it has about 1,300 joules, so it's too low by about 1,200 joules in just 6 hours. And if we look at 18Z, on the right is the mu cape forecast from the GFS, on the left is the RAP analysis at that time. we're missing a lot of instability in the model. So the GFS wouldn't be nearly as supportive of severe weather, even in the first 6 hours of the forecast in this particular case. And there was substantial severe down in the lower Mississippi Valley, including hail to baseball size and an EF2 tornado, along with wind damage. So these two cases I've included to illustrate that there are times that the models do not start out well enough in their details to allow us to start out making a good short-term forecast. And that's why we have to pay attention, not just to the models, but to the observational data. So, some guidelines. Things do change. I think you can tell from the picture on the left to the picture on the right. Things are a little bit different over the course of 60 years or so, but the fact that we're still doing hand-drawn charts suggests that some skill sets don't change dramatically, although I think you can tell there's a lot more computer monitors on the right picture than in the left picture, needless to say. So this information is in your, I think it's on the web page that Ariel had put together in terms of analysis of the different chart levels. So I don't need to go through this in a great amount of detail. I'll say 850 chart. One of the things that we do is we typically analyze temperature and dew point at 2 degree intervals, not 5 degree intervals, because we're interested in the details more. And I'll give you some examples of this. An additional problem, of course, is the last bullet, is the surface. 850 surface is typically below ground in the western parts of the US. So it's not as useful out there. 700 is, and again, 2 degree intervals. 500 millibar chart, we will do a little bit more with that at times, but I'll give you some examples. And 250, we don't do as much analysis. We're primarily interested in the jet structure and where maxima are located. So they're automatically plotted out at SPC twice daily. And one of the things that can be very helpful is to compare the charts at 12-hour intervals. As you saw in the April 3rd, 1974 outbreak sequence of charts, to actually see how things are changing. One of the things that's important is that last bullet, continuity. If features are sticking around for a period of time, they probably have some importance to them. And we want to make sure that we're not missing them. So here's a particular case that we're going to do some work, and we're actually going to have some time because I've talked quickly today to actually start some chart analysis if you're really up to it. Because everybody's brought their colored pencils, and this is when we, you know, get to pretend we're back in kindergarten and first grade. And it is interesting because sometimes we have school groups that come through tours of this building, and they'll come by the SPC and they'll look in through the windows, and they'll see people sometimes with colored pencils and charts, and the kids, especially in the early elementary school grades get kind of excited where they say, look, they get the color at work. Kind of neat. So this was an important severe weather day where there's a high risk that was issued, significant tornadoes, a number of fatalities, particularly in Arkansas. And I'll give you copies of this. This is what the upper air charts look like the evening before. So this is what the outlook forecaster for day one would have had available, with a strong digging jet along the west coast, high amplitude pattern that you can see, actual 500 millibar analysis, again, in red, temperature 2 degree intervals, geopotential height at 60 meter intervals, those are the black lines, 12 hour height changes in blue and orange. And the reason we do them in orange instead of red is so you can distinguish them from the red isotherms a little bit easier. So you can see the trough in the east with a cold core right up through here. 80-meter height falls in advance, 120-meter height rises to its rear, and then this sharp trough in terms of a thermal trough as well as some stronger winds in the base of it, height rises, height falls ahead of it. So a progressive pattern with systems that are moving, when you see the height falls ahead, height rises behind, typically means a progressive system. And that's what we had in this case, was a fairly progressive pattern, system after system coming on through. 700 millibars, again, on this one, put height rises and height falls, although we normally might not do that. But one of the things that we wanted to take a look at here, it's a little hard to see, but right in through here is the 500 millibar trough back into eastern Arizona and maybe southwest New Mexico. And if I leave the cursor right here and move ahead, all right, whoops, I guess that didn't like that. You've got some pretty strong cold advection at 700 millibars below the 500 millibar trough. And QG theory is going to tell you what about that. That trough at 500 is probably going to deepen. The heights are going to fall further, in part because of the cold advection beneath it. And when we look at charts like this, we have an understanding of maybe what's taking place in the short term. Now, admittedly, most folks nowadays would probably say, well, I just look at the model. It's going to tell me what the large-scale pattern is going to do. And most of the time, it's pretty good. But do you have a sense if somebody says, well, what's that trough going to do? And you'll say, well, I think it's going to deepen some. And they say, well, why is that going to happen? And you say, well, because the model says it's going to happen. And then they look at you and say, well, why does the model say it's going to happen? And what's your answer going to be? Well, I don't know. I just listen to the model. It's kind of nice. It's a little satisfying to have a sense of what is the atmosphere doing? What are the processes at play such that I have a sense of what's going to happen because I'm doing some analysis and this is what's happening right now and what has been happening. Let's take a look at the 850 chart. And again, strong southerly flow. We're seeing moisture increases. They're not shown, I know right here, dew points up 16 at Springfield in the last 12 hours, up 38 at Little Rock in the last 12 hours. So there's a lot of changes taking place in through here. And you can pretty much get a sense from the isotherm analysis where there are baroclinic zones or fronts. They can be fair, you know, somewhat close to the ground, and even a dry line type feature can show up at 850 in terms of where the moist axis is and what's coming in immediately to the west of it. So these are things that if you do this right and you're thinking about the data, you're not just mindlessly drawing isoplets between data points. If you're thinking about it while you're doing it, you're gaining a sense of what the atmosphere looked like at upper air time. And if you compare it to where it was the previous 12 hours, you gain a sense of how things have been changing and what's actually happening from real data. And it can help you in interpretation of the model data.